thank you to HowlRound for partnering with us on this. As we learned last night, these issues are incredibly important, so we're just thrilled to be talking about them. Also, a big thank you to the Lark, because this space is fantastic. Cell phones, please silence them, but tweet to your heart's content, because I will be right there, our panelists will be as well. So feel free to tweet and ask questions. There will be questions from the audience as well. And it's hashtag RightSweet is what you should be using. And then also be sure on your way out, there's a white piece of paper. It's our white paper, more information about anti-piracy. So please feel free to grab it for more information. And there are still two more panels this week, so I hope that you join us. Just so you all know, the rains today have held up one of our panelists, but he's on the way. So if someone comes in late and sits down, that's why. So now I'm going to hand it over to a wonderful moderator, Morgan Jenness, and she's going to introduce everyone else here. So take it away.
I'm really happy to be here. I'm really happy to be here with these other people on the panel, because the question today is kind of the Hamlet question: to license or not to license. You know, especially when you're a playwright, you know, when do you license your play? But it really gets interesting when you're in a collaborative situation, when, you know, you're co-writing with someone, when you're devising as a group. And there's all kinds of interesting questions that come up. Also, when you're sort of making a schematic that's not necessarily, that's something that changes, something that is kind of the bones of the play that gets improvised in different settings. So it's a real question of, like, are you the only ones who can do this play? Can other people do the play? What kind of choices do you make? And also, what are the decisions within a collaboration? So all the kind of complexities that come up about licensing and non-licensing. So what's exciting about this panel is that we have people who work collaboratively. We have people who have been published independently as authors. We have people who are actors and writers. We have presenters who work with several groups. So it's a really, we're going to have a very interesting range, and I want to quickly go down to who we have. So the first three people here at the end are part of the Debate Society. I hope you have seen them. If you have not, they are, you know, well, you're touring a little now, more, right? But they are in New York City. For you people in New York City, you should see them. They are amazing. Buddy Cop changed. It did change my life. I went, this is what's possible in the theater. So we have Hannah Bose, Paul Thureen, and Oliver Butler from the Debate Society. More about themselves when we open into it. Then we're going to have two people. We have John Dowgin, and we're waiting for Michael DeAngelis from the Porch Room, which is a company that's based in Philadelphia. And you work collaboratively with two other writers, sometimes another writer generally.
Writer, director, actor, whatever we need to work.
Writer, director.
Whatever we need to be for that particular.
Right. So there's various roles that are taken up. You're also a screenwriter. So there's various hats that people wear, and when they wear those hats, and then who has a say in how the work gets done. And you also, I want to talk about something because John had a very intriguing thing when he was sort of tweeting out, I think it was a tweet, to his constituency saying, we're going to also talk about self-licensing. And that really intrigued me. So,
Mike said we're going to talk about that.
Oh, well, good.
I'll take advantage of his absence.
Okay, good. Several of these artists, Sam French has had the great good taste to publish already, I would say. But it's an interesting thing in terms of when do you go to a publisher and what's the idea of self-licensing as well, how do you get a book out. And then here right next to me is Ronee Penoi, who has a company called Theater from the District. And she works with several interesting ensembles and companies. The one I think we'll talk about the most is probably Dowgin. Most companies you're working with are based in D.C., is that right?
Yeah.
All of them are based in D.C. And Dowgin Pony is interesting because I really talk specifically about a project called Beer Town, which is a really unique situation. If you look at, like, the credits for people of, like, whose credit is a writer, whose credit is a developer, you know, of a script, and also who's credited as, in your case, I think the devising company is the credit, yeah. So anyway, these are briefly who our fabulous people are on the panel. So the question I want to ask to open it up to is how, when, what's the advantages, disadvantages of getting a script out there that you've developed that's very much kind of part of who you are as performers, as devisers, as actors, and when is it good to get it out there for other people to do, and when do you maybe think, well, no, it's not actually something that I think other people can do. So do you guys want to talk about that?
Sure. So really quickly, three of us create plays together. We conceptualize and develop them together. Ultimately, Hannah and I write the script and are in the plays. Oliver directs them, but the three of us sort of create the world of the play together. So we sort of share authorship. And we just had our 10-year anniversary, and in that time we've made 8 full-length plays. And our first 3 plays were just written for me and Hannah as performers. I think we never really considered the idea of writing for other people. We were writing for our company. I think it was Amy Rose Marsh from Seminar French who was the first person who approached us after Buddy Cop 2 about the possibility of licensing it. And so there's a lot of questions about what is a debate society play, because our plays, as we developed, did start to read more like scripts, not just sort of performance texts. They sort of read like a play.
Right.
But there was more to the play than just the text. We sort of start with the mood and the feeling of the world, and as we write the plays, we're also collecting the props that are going to be in the plays, and those details are really important to us. So for us, the big question was, if we, being excited about somebody else taking our plays and seeing what they would do with them, but also wondering about these elements that maybe aren't reflected on this on the page,
right,
how much that is the play. And then also, the other big concern was just confusion. If people saw a production of Buddy Cop 2 and said, oh, I know the Debate Society, I saw that play.
Right.
And how we explained to people, well, that wasn't the Debate Society, that was a play that we wrote.
Right.
And so those were, I think, sort of like the early things that we really were wrestling with for a long time as we
right.
figured out how to move forward.
And Hannah, you've written plays that you've just done on your own as well, right?
I have, but yeah, I mean, I have. I write other things, and then I also act in other people's plays.
Right.
But the plays that I make with the Debate Society are a thing to its own.
Right.
Yeah, and we're also sort of in the devised category sometimes, depending on the way people talk about devising.
And does everyone else here really understand the nature of devised work and what happens? Let's talk. Maybe we can talk a little bit about that.
Sure. Well, that's funny because it's not a word that we use to describe
ourselves.
Yeah. People lay that on top of us, and I think that there is sort of. I this might be wrong, but I feel like playwrights write plays just as differently from each other as companies create plays differently from each other, and devise sort of has become this catch-all for ensemble-created work where it's not just a single playwright who writes a play and hands it off. And so for some companies that means that a script comes out of improvisation or any different ways of doing it. So we sometimes get lumped in that. We don't use that term for ourselves, but that's...
Would you say collaborative, or what do you
think? We are. Yeah. We use collaborative a lot.
Yeah, I think that's,
especially at the beginning of our process when we know what we think our play might be about and we're over-creating this world. I mean, there's still writing involved in an early stage, but it's really 3 people in a room creating together.
Right.
Sometimes it's on its feet, but sometimes it has lists. I mean, it has so many different elements that is, you know, uniquely ours, and then also probably a lot of people do it as well.
Right.
And then there's a point where the script comes, but we are all 3 sort of creating at the same time.
I think there's some companies that they create a piece and then they perform it and then they sort of document it afterwards. We just worked with a Philly company called Team Sunshine
right.
in a workshop, and that's what they do. They're like, well, we don't really have scripts. When we're done, we kind of try to...
Right, the script happens when you're done. Whereas you really create it in the process.
We write a play, and
right.
so when we're done, we have,
right.
you know, we're going into rehearsal with the...
Right.
Right,
John. Is that more the way you guys work as well?
Kind of, sort of. We all consider ourselves writers. Some of us consider ourselves actors, writers.
Right.
And then there's me who considers himself actor, director, writer. So that works out pretty well. And I think we all sort of took the same path that actors who find themselves writing and directing take. We start out as actors. And we say, well, this director has no idea what he's talking about. Director. And then you realize, well, the director's fine. It's actually the play that's bad. So you come around to writing your own work to fill the gaps that you see in the theater. Basically, the way it works is somebody will have an idea, or two people have an idea. And they'll throw the idea out there, and it'll either spark to you or you don't. And you say, well, I'm interested in helping you with that, or I'm interested in flat out writing that with you, or I'm not interested in that at all, but I want to see what you do with it, so right. Go to it. And we're all, one of the reasons that the three of us work so well together is that we write so differently to what you were saying about the way playwrights approach plays completely differently. Pete will send me something, or Mike will send me something, and I'll be like, That is wonderful, and I would never in a million years.
This is Pete Barry. He's not going to be here, but Mike's going
to
be here.
And I would never in a million years have thought to put those words together in that order to achieve the effect that we have. But I see it from another way, so I'm going to take it, and I'm going to put it on its feet this way, and we'll try it two or three different ways, and we'll see what happens. I mean, the one thing you do have to get to is you have to get comfortable enough with each other that you can say to each other, yes, this is fantastic, but pages 10 through 37 have to go. You have to get to the ability where you know you trust each other enough to speak frankly.
And is that kind of a decision that you all agree to collectively?
It has to be. Right. I mean, ultimately, at the outset, one person or two people or all three of you, you'll become the writer, and the decisions become based on that decision you made.
Right, and that's something we're going to talk about too, in terms of, is there an ultimate responsibility that, you know, gives over in terms of someone really taking the mantle of the identity of a writer? Is it a collective? Also, who makes the decisions about production and licensing and all that kind of thing? Because it can get complicated. You've got a lot of people in the room who are collaborating. Some sort of, you know, there has to be some sort of agreement in terms of that. We'll get to that. So let's talk about Dog and Pony, especially with a show like Beer Town. Which was done here in New York. Did anyone see Beer Town? Yeah, it's a very different animal. Let's talk about Beer Town a little bit.
Yeah, so.
And Dog and Pony's process.
Yeah, so I work with Dog and Pony DC as their touring producer, and it's been really interesting working with Rachel Grossman, who's one of Dog and Pony DC's ringleaders, as they figure out what they're going to do with Beer Town in this next step, because it's interesting. You wouldn't normally think that licensing and touring have much to do with each other, but in this case, I think one is really going to inform the other. So, but backing up a second, so Dog and Pony DC, the way they make their work is in this kind of ensemble devised model. So as a group, they come together around an idea, and over a long period of time, they'll develop shows. But for each individual project, different ensemble members will take the lead as the director, kind of as the lead, you know, on that particular project. But what's interesting, as the shows have been premiered and then have gone on, and this has happened in the case of Beer Town, is that different ensemble members will swap into in and out of different roles. So, you know, when it travels, someone may be playing the role of, you know, the mayor, you know, in a different way than had been previously. So it's not so much, you know, these are the actors, these are the directors, and we come together to develop the show, but it's very, very fluid in terms of who does what role. But I think probably the thing that sets Dog and Pony DC apart in an interesting way is their investigation of what they like to call audience integration. What that basically means is that the audience is, you know, not only engaged in the show in an interesting way, but they actually have agency. So we say about Beer Town that it's about 60% Dog and Pony DC and about 40% of the audience generating material. So in Beer Town, when you first come into the show,
I'm gonna give you a little sense of what this experience is, because it's very unique. Yeah.
So when you come in to be part of the audience of Beer Town, you're cast as a citizen of Beer Town, and you've shown up to a town meeting where there are different artifacts that are going to be either voted in or voted out of the town time capsule. So it's the town's quinquennial celebration, and there is pageantry, there is a you know, everyone stands and does the Pledge of Allegiance, everyone sings the Beer Town song, and you are very much with a t-shirt and with a dessert potluck that kicks off the show, and yes, you bring a dessert. You know, that is the world that you come into. So, you know, the first part of the show, there's a lot of, you know, conversation around what these artifacts are,
But then in the second half, you have, you know, audience members coming forward and saying, you know, I really want to vote for, you know, that projector from the old movie theater to be in that time capsule because I remember when my grandfather, you know, went to see a show when, you know, yada yada. And so you're doing not only as a, you know, the artist.
You have a guideline too. What's that word?
Yeah.
It's important. It's like.
Heart.
Heart.
Yes.
Heart.
There's like a guide. The different characteristics that each artifact must have. And so, you know, as an audience member, you're going, well, you know, it has, it was heat.
Heat. Right.
You know, so does it have these different, you know, characteristics that should justify being into the time capsule or not? So it's interesting when you talk about licensing something like that. You know, that is 40% the audience experience, and in a way, as on the artist side, you're not just performing something that's been predetermined, you're improvising and you're also facilitating, this is the part that's probably most important to Dowgin Pony, is you're facilitating the audience's experience so that they can have a value-based conversation that's exciting to them. So you'll get a great debate between, you know, a little kid and an older gentleman, you know, politely saying, well, I disagree with you, you know, between the two of them about which artifact should get voted in.
Yeah, so the audience is improvising along, and the actors have to respond to that improvisation, right?
Yeah.
So it's dramaturgy on the spot. So how do you license dramaturgy on the spot? You know, and also performance-wise, because your performance elements, I mean, the whole thing, you know, with the squash game, you know, there's a dramaturgy to how that game is played. You just don't say to, you know, officers go and play squash. There's a kind of rhythm to it and an orchestration to it, right? So, you know, but has Buddy Cop been
helping? It's with Sam French, and it's had two licensed productions.
Have you seen
one in Chicago?
I'll have another one in Chicago.
Fall.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Did you see the other productions?
We did.
Hannah saw the one in Durham.
We saw the other.
And how do you sort of, how much control do you have over it? How much of an issue? What's that like?
We've sort of been really hands-off with them.
Okay.
And we've just sort of shown up and seen, it's like, you know, visiting your kid at camp.
Visiting your older kid at camp,
right?
Because it's like you have
your
to kind of,
at camp.
You have to kind of let it go.
It is
like a parent.
There was never any question. I never remember having a question about whether we should or shouldn't license our work. I think we didn't know whether it was appropriate to license it or whether anyone would be interested in licensing it earlier in our process. But I don't think that we ever had any like. Should we never license the
tour? Yeah, there's never a
I think we're always excited.
Never,
yeah, we're always like excited by the idea.
Yeah, also like there are a few cities we wanted to hit maybe on tours before licensing them.
That was always the big consideration, was making sure that we could have the life that we wanted with our own production and not get in the way of any other sort of license.
Was there a holdback? The licensing? What a
we would,
is, like you say, this play can be done in these cities, but not in these places.
It's funny because it's something that we don't worry about anymore, because when we first did it, I think we didn't know how it worked, so I don't remember the exact details, but I think what we worked out is for Buddy Cop 2, we decided for the first year, we would basically have, you know, there were a few cities that we were like, okay, we want to know, before we grant a license to these cities, we get to okay that, and then after a year. But the thing is that we license, so if we're doing it again, we license our own production. So we have to go through which we were like, oh, is that going to be weird? But it's actually great.
Can you explain that a little bit?
I really like that. I think before we did it, we were like, well, this is going to be weird because then do we have to license it from Semi-French when we do it? Because, you know, otherwise they would be losing money when we would, you know, if we're doing it in Chicago, right?
Right.
But we get, you know, we get our licensing percentage from that anyway, so it's kind of fun to
you
be like,
yourself.
Okay, we're paying ourselves. So now we're not so worried about losing that. And you know, we aren't the type of company that want to be on the road 8 months a year. You know, it's just a few specific spots. So I think that was something that we anticipated being a bigger problem. Than it was, but
I think it was a Sam French contract possibly, but there was a point at which we were deciding which cities we like wanted sort of off the table for a year.
Yeah.
And we included a few international cities, like it was like Berlin or something. And I think what we didn't know is like they weren't, at least for that contract, they weren't handling anything internationally. But they did us the service of they put in like Berlin, New York or something. they didn't make us feel like idiots. They were like, oh, yes, they must be talking about Berlin, New York.
Which were huge in Berlin.
Yeah, we're like, great art scene in Berlin. Something like that.
I had a bad experience.
New York is going to start like tweeting like crazy that they're mad now. We're going to get all these like angry Berlin.
Yeah. Are you dissing Berlin?
Yeah, exactly. Like,
connected to like that, we have a show called You're Welcome. You're Welcome, which is a cycle of bad plays that has this sort of like well-made scene in it that was totally improvised. We don't usually improvise. That's the only thing that we've ever done that was live improvisation on stage. But it nobody knew it was improvised. But oh, the writing in that was really, really great. I'm like, yeah, okay, thank you. But so when that was published, we weren't sure if we should if that was important, if we should just sort of like write that scene. And right. What we ended up doing is having like guidelines for the key points that they had to hit, saying, okay, the next is a 20-minute improvised scene that shouldn't be improvised. It should happen. This needs to happen. It should end with these lines. Do what you want. If it's kids, you can have it be kids. If it's adults, and I think in our other scripts that aren't improvised, there's still moments that when we are preparing the script for publication, that we're asking how much of this is actually important to tell people. It needs to be this mood. It needs to be this rhythm. How much of that, the stage magic, is it important that the actor spins the racket at this point? Probably not. Maybe that's just our thing. So that's what we're weighing, like what is important to the core of the story that needs to be included, and what do we want people to figure out themselves.
Right. Which is an issue for Beertown too. You nodded your head when he was talking about appropriate. Is it appropriate? So I'm curious about what does that mean.
Is it appropriate to be licensed, or is anybody interested in licensing?
Oh, so
for me,
yeah.
It's always, is anybody interested? Do you want to license us? Yes, please, go ahead. We don't have anything that's nearly that level of free form or improvised along the way. I mean, we have improvised as performing our shows, don't get me wrong. it's always a question of, I think if a publishing house is interested in licensing it, if they think there is a market for it, then by all means, go ahead and license it. If there is something, like I have a play that's written very specifically for one particular theater, place. It is written around the history of this theater. It is written around the physical constraints of this theater. It is written with a fair amount of in-jokes for the people who know this theater.
Right.
And I have done a pass of it, and I've tried to take all that out.
The specific details.
Can I take the theater specificity out of it, and make a version of it that is licensable for a broader audience? So I finally reached the conclusion that I couldn't do it.
You couldn't do it.
So what we do with the quote unquote self licensing, which is basically plays that we have produced that Samuel French or another publisher has not picked up. We've done a performance of it, and we like it. We haven't done a performance of it. We don't think it could ever possibly be done on a stage. We don't, we don't particularly care about that, because there, for all I know, there's people out there who know the exact way to do that, to do that play. We put it up on the website.
That's an interesting
thing.
We say,
hey, here you go. We wrote this. We don't know what to do with it. You guys want to take a stand?
And is it a Creative Commons situation that they just kind of do it because of some of you know about Charles Mee, Chuck Mee, and a lot of the adaptations that he's done, especially of Greek plays? He has a website that he basically puts the word up. And young companies, he says, he's pulled from all kinds of other sources that some are in the public domain, some of them he doesn't have underlying rights to, and so it's a kind of a rights nightmare, I think, when you open up, licensing, really traditional licensing for Chuck Mee. And the other thing is like, I want young companies to do this, and he kind of says, this is the way I've approached it. You want to put in other texts, you don't want to use a Rambo play, you want to use a different song in this, moment. You can do what you want, it's a Greek play, there's things, that, I want you to credit if you're going to use what I'm doing, but it's out there and run with it. So that's...
You get to the point where what good is it sitting on your hard drive?
Right.
Yeah.
If you want...
You want people to do it.
It's open source. It's open source programming for the theatrical world. It's... Right. We have done this. We think it's fun. Go ahead. Fly. Be free. We used to just have a tip jar on the website. I don't think we ever made a dime.
Well, that people could donate and say, you know.
We tried the Radiohead model, forgetting momentarily that we are not actually Radiohead. So, I don't think we ever made a dime off it. And now we sort of list suggested prices in line with the licensing fees.
Right.
Again, I don't know if anybody's ever actually done it.
And you don't really monitor, and you don't like follow up, which is a really interesting thing, you know? Like, at what point, you know, is there a point where you feel, okay, all these people are doing it and they're selling tickets and whatever?
If people start to do the plays and they start to publicize the plays, as you will do when you do a play, you'll find out about it.
Right.
Eventually. I
have a Google check on yourself and your work.
I have something better than a Google check. I have my father.
Tell us about your father.
My father has a Google check. We have the same name. So...
Oh,
he has a Google check on him, but he started finding my place. And it's funny when you get published how quickly your sensibilities shift to the right side of the political spectrum. I get an email from my dad 6 in the morning. Hey, they're doing your play in Indiana. That's fantastic. Samuel French, have they paid for the play in Indiana? But
I tell you what, our Google alert for blood play. I just disabled it yesterday because
you got so much other stuff.
I would get 10 Google alerts a day that were either for T-shirts that said "Give blood, play hockey," or you know, fetish websites.
So, yeah. But you still have the fetish stuff.
So I still got two of the hockey T-shirts.
So. Or with Beer Town, like how do they, you know, in talking about whether to license that, how do you license it, what goes into a published script, what are the kinds of conversations of something that's a real schematic for not only actor improvisation, but audience improvisation?
Yeah, so I feel like Dowgin Point is very much in the place of, you know, not having had anything licensed yet, really kind of asking all of these questions and kind of talking to other people and, you know, thinking about what is the way to learn more. Because one of the biggest challenges with Dowgin Point's work is that even I'm sure as I'm explaining to you what the show is right now, I think the few of you who've seen the show can attest that it's a very different experience.
Made it through the storm. I feel like we should sing a Peggy Lee song to you at the end of the storm.
Today I was part of Amtrak's new writer hostage program. Actually keep you in Philadelphia for 3 hours.
So did Sam French got the check? Fabulous. Thank you, Sam French, for
getting
him out of the train.
Are you done interrupting this nice lady?
I am. Pretend I'm not here.
So go to train entrance. So I was saying that the experience of being in Beer Town is very different than hearing what it's about or what the experience is, and I think the few of you who are at the show will probably nod your heads at that. So one of the things that Dowgin Point is looking at and is that we're going after together, including me, is looking at doing a Beer Town Takes America tour. And it's not your typical tour in that it's not the entire Dowgin Point DC company going to Omaha and doing the show. Instead, it's, okay, can we take a couple, you know, 1 to 3 Dowgin Point DC members and collaborate with a group of artists, you know, people in that city, and develop a beer town for that particular city, maybe even swap out some artifacts that are a little more exciting, or talk about, like, what are the themes that that city is grappling with right now. And in a way, by going to all of these different cities, doing this, you know, what they're calling partial presence model, you know, we'll kind of learn and get a sense of, okay, so when, you know, when we say X, are they hearing X or are they hearing Y? And like working with other artists who are kind of new to the world of Beer Town, we're hoping will give us a lot of valuable information so that when we're building this, you know, licensing, we'll have a sense of what to do. So one of the things that we've talked about early on doing is kind of a Beer Town Bible. Because one of the things that people who have come to see the show have said is, well, how could anybody else but you do the show? Because you know everything about the history of Beer Town. So if someone says, well, you know, where did the wood from that bar come from? It'll be like, oh, well, it came from this particular manufacturer, and you'll remember that that person, their grandfather founded the town, or, you know, there's just this whole deep world of information that can come out in improv. So in licensing, it's not just the okay, this person says X, this person says B, and then you let the audience talk for a while. It's more like, okay, here is the world of knowledge and history about this town that every cast member knows, and also here is the Bible for each individual, you know, or for each individual character, for where they're coming from, what their kind of background is in relationship to the other characters. So it's interesting to think about it as not like even maybe as just a play, but as a play with all of this other additional materials.
So waiting until there's more productions, waiting until you really like have more information that can go into this Bible is actually better than having rushed to get the play out there into publication.
That's the thought right now.
No, it makes sense. It makes sense that there's all these different variations and you want as many of them as possible.
Yeah, and also too realizing that putting together that kind of body of work and having it make sense to other people other than us who are so familiar with the work will take time. You know, and we'll take kind of a trial and error and experimental period before it's, okay, this is ready to go to be licensed.
Right. So, Michael.
Hello.
Hi. So glad you made it. So we talked a little bit about what's put up on the website, the kind of is like self-licensing and the tip jar. And, you know, so what, can you talk a little bit about, because you've also had things public, Accidents Happen, I think, has had a really nice life, you know, that was published.
Yes.
Can you talk about, are there decisions in that, and or talk about your relationship with your collaborators?
Sure.
Say whatever you want to say.
All right. Well, because we're not only writers, but we're producing a lot of our own work, a lot of times we find that takes us out of contention of submitting it to places, because a lot of times they'll say, you know, it can't have had a major production or have any sort of production. And if we put something up in Philadelphia or in New York, those are pretty big, you know, arenas to play in. But we put a lot of work into it, we put a lot of love into it, and from my perspective, I think you'll probably agree with me, sometimes you don't know what works until you've seen it.
Yeah.
And so, you know, there are things we've done now 2 times, 3 times, and, you know, there are less opportunities for us to send it out to the world, so we'll send it out there ourselves. So a lot of what's up on the website for people to do if they like are things that we kind of road tested ourselves and think are really viable shows.
Yeah. They tend to be a little more traditional, not improvisational. I can see how something like Beer Town you would want to keep hands on at least for the first several iterations. We have more traditional sort of, what's the word I'm looking for?
I don't know.
Nothing new there.
Dramaturgy. What did Dow just throw in?
That's good.
Yeah. Dramaturgy. Just throw it in. Whatever word you're missing,
dramaturgically traditional words that, you know, that we can trust somebody to pick up and not, not
right. It's sort of, it doesn't need a Bible, perhaps.
Yes.
The way that showed us. And again, like I said, a lot of the things that we have been sort of lab tested, road tested. They have been reviewed, they positive reviews.
Yeah. When we started out, we tried to do things that we could do ourselves, things that we could do simply, things that we could do on a day's notice, just ourselves. Somebody has a space you need, and great, we're going. And the first time we did that, we did a show, and we put it up in a week's notice, and there were some pros and there were some cons, and I had, this was actually before you were a member of the group, it was just me and Pete, and I called Pete and I said, all right, so the next show we do has to be even simpler than that. It has to be even less complicated than that, because that was more than we were prepared to handle. And he sends me a play 4 days later and I'm reading it and I'm like, all right, there's a chair and a desk, great. Guy comes in with, you know, he's holding something small, he's got a pen, all right, that's a pen we can do, that's fine, great. Page 17, on walk 2, people carrying a live octopus. And I put it down. And I pick up the phone. And he said, hello. And I said, I can point to the page where you completely disregarded everything we talked about last week. He's like, I know, but I had to bring on the octopus.
And did the octopus stay?
The octopus did stay.
It did, and that was published.
The octopus is published.
The octopus
so
is published.
So after the octopus was published, I learned, all right, fine, you do whatever you want.
Uh-huh.
You put an octopus on the page, and it got published. So.
And the octopus is out in the world and being done?
Yeah. I believe the octopus is being done.
There you see. See? People find ways to
I think we've given up on trying to do the simple show, but we did continually try. When we were trying to tour more, we thought, like, the key to it is, like, just come up with a show that's much more simply done. I feel like we would start with the intention to do, you know, the suitcase show, and then you just black out and wake up 6 months later in front of, like,
this mess.
Yeah. Real cars and stuff. What happened?
Well, it's interesting because doing something simple is a consideration for a lot of theaters all over. I think it's a consideration in terms of when you license. I worked at an agency for a number of years, and you have that conversation with theaters, you know, that spring slot, that maybe they're going to do something, you know, produce something, bring in a company. I was very gung-ho about saying, bring in an ensemble, you know, because you'll do something, you know, it's done, you can bring it in, it's less risk, you have it, you know, it can open up the parameters of what you're doing. A lot of theaters are going, oh, yeah, okay, do you have a comedy that's three actors or less and one set really simply done, right? Yeah, okay, a lot of us have experienced that. We kind of go, really? Is this what the theater has become? But it's interesting. It's like when you license, do you find that that's true? But none of you really do it.
Well, sometimes the opposite. If it's, if it's you know, a college production, which we haven't had, but there, you know, there was, of our play, You're Welcome, that they were asking if they could add, you know, they're like, well, we have five, you know, younger students, can we add them as, you know, stagehands or in this scene, you know, so some, you know, there are times where they'll want to do more, you know, all those things just have to be handled on a case-by-case
You're Welcome basis, sort of made for that kind of thing. It's, you know, a series of bad plays on purpose, sort of team failing people. So there's a lot of room for good failure.
But, you know, I would say normally people are like, can we add another character to Buddy Cop 2? We'd be like,
No.
So constructed, Yeah. And that's the question, you know, in terms of, I mean, you don't even, you know, when a play goes out there, how much control does any writer have? I mean, ask Shakespeare, right?
Ask the writer Shakespeare story.
That's all the writer Shakespeare stole from, that's right.
I think something we've learned, or I think we might be doing more in future scripts for licensing, is deal, just being clearer about how to deal with a lot of the silence and the mood that's so important to us. Like, mood is so important, and we spend, as Paul said, so much time sort of infusing the mood of the play with rich detail. And I think our plan right now is to just open ourselves up to have more conversations with licensing theaters, so that we can explain, you know, maybe stuff that's impossible to put into a script.
I think that's very interesting, because as I was recently just working on our website and looking at our script library, something that struck me about a lot of our scripts are sort of the author's note or disclaimer at the front that says, okay, so this calls for an octopus, or this calls for a roller coaster, but it could be done with suggestion, or it could be done very elaborately. We put that into your hands. What's important is what comes across. And I found that, you know, time and time again, I was like, you know, I think because we came from the roots of, okay, we've got a room and a chair, but we're going to do a play about a roller coaster. You know, I think we are very encouraging of people finding their way into these perhaps elaborate or crazy worlds that we've created, where there are octopuses and ancient Egypt ghosts coming back to life, and, you know, allowing it to be done with a chair and a pen.
But maybe that's not a bad benchmark for it. If there is something that is so integral to the story that it can't be done without it, and you can't communicate that in words, in text, maybe that's the line you have to cross before you can say, all right, it's ready to be licensed. Because you can't always be there.
Right.
You can't always, if you can't communicate it in the words on the page, then it's probably not something you're ready to put out there for the world.
And what if that is an actor in a performance? And does that happen? You know, I mean, where you can't see people other than...
Didn't you guys get the casting call for the Boston... I remember,
yeah,
they were like, ooh, the casting call for the Boston production of Buddy Cop is happening. They were, they were thinking of going in and auditioning. It's like, oh,
to see if you'd get
yeah, and be like,
fake names.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I'd be like, must have like a 6'4" and a, you know, man and a 5-foot-tall woman for like, you know, best comedic effect, you know. But
is that part of the set? Like, is that how?
No.
But could it be? I mean, when is, you know, are there times for any of you where you kind of go, no, actually, as great as this would be for other people to do it, there's no way other people can do it, either because of
personally, no. I would never speak for another writer. Personally, no. I would never, because I have in the past, decided that this is for one person and one person only.
Right.
And it usually doesn't work. It's nowhere near what you think.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
Our second play has like 5 or 6 lines of actual dialogue, and it's unpublished, and it's like a list of actions. It's written...
it's like an hour and a half long play with...
And I think that we have like a very special, intimate relationship with that play, and I feel like we want to do it one more time to see what that was. It was like our second play we did, you know, 8 years ago, before we probably published that. And even looking at that script, it's, you know, like, theater is such a crazy medium. It's all so not permanent, and... especially with our company, we like learned who we were by making this second play together. Because our first play was it was an adaptation and used writings of someone else, and based on someone else. So that new one we've never published, and it's like a list of actions. Like, I couldn't imagine publishing that, but we keep talking all the time about how awesome it would be
if somebody else did
to publish that.
Right.
Yeah.
But you want to go into it one more time, so
yeah,
you feel like you can let the kid go to camp on it.
Yeah,
exactly.
Which I think is an interesting thing.
Yeah. I think Dowgin Penoi is actually about to have a really interesting learning experience that this is making me think of. So in Omaha, there is a great theater called Omaha Community Playhouse, and it is a professional community theater in Omaha, established in there many, many decades. Dowgin Penoi is going to be bringing Beer Town out there. And in that instance, you know, a couple of Dowgin Penoi members are going to go out there and essentially cast the show from the community. So not even, you know, so much like, okay, we're going to cast professional actors in this, but we're casting from the community that would, you know, be performing in these plays and everything. So I think that's going to be a really interesting experience for whoever goes out there, because in addition to these auditions, there's going to be pre-audition workshops and things like that to get people both excited about and kind of wrapping their heads around what Dowgin Penoi does and what is this audience integration thing that they're, you know, trying to do. So I think that'll be an interesting moment, as I think that'll be the first time that we're putting completely new faces in these roles in an interesting way.
Yeah, that's
But just speaking generally in theatrical terms, the best experiences I've ever had, either as a director or a writer or an actor for that matter, has been with the actor who you never in a million years would have imagined would be right for the part. I did a play where I invited an actor to come lead for one of the two key male roles. And I just assumed he knew who I was calling him to read for.
So he came for the other role?
He should have, presuming I had called him for the other.
Right.
I said, you're completely wrong for that part.
Right.
He's like, F I am. Let me show you. And he auditioned, and he was right.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And the flip side of that is the plays that we've written for ourselves. Like Drop is a play that's set on a roller coaster that has stopped, overlooking the drop. And it's about the two guys who are stuck on the roller coaster, and the conversation they have while they're looking over the drop. And Mike and Pete wrote it. And I'm in it. I have a smaller role of the maintenance man who comes up to fix it. This is like the first 15 times we did the show, it was the three of us. But it's about two guys who are at a very particular point in their lives. By which I mean they're in their 20s. So about a year ago, or 2 years ago, one of you, I forget which one of you it was, sends the email and says, yeah, I think we're officially going to stop doing job. And I don't think I've ever told you this. I thought to myself, thank God I don't have to say it. Thank God
that's right. The cast list says Mike and Pete
the early mid-20s. Jackson, any age. So you're, no, I can do this forever.
You 60 away. Years old.
Yes. Yes. That is a different kind of drop, right? Can you talk a little bit about Transit Lounge and You Are Dead, You Are Here?
Oh, sure.
Yeah, because that's an interesting thing with the collaboration between a video artist and a playwright. And what do you do in that situation?
Yeah. So Transit Lounge is a very interesting ensemble in that it's comprised of three artists who typically work as a playwright, Christine Evans, a projection designer, video designer, Jared Mazzocchi, and Joseph Magel, who works as a director. But what's interesting about what brought them together is they came together for this one particular show because they were really fascinated by, this software. It's called Virtual Iraq, and essentially it was developed by the military to help veterans who are returning from Iraq with PTSD. So it's essentially a virtual reality software. And through a lot of building of relationships, they got the rights to utilize that software and all of the equipment that goes with it. And essentially, that is the projection design and really the set design for the show, is it's all this video design world. And you're with the veteran and his therapist and this Iraqi girl blogger. And you're kind of going between these two worlds, and essentially the virtual world of Iraq becomes the real world for this, you know, Iraqi girl. So they had a production at Here Art Center in June of last year that really, really kind of moved forward for them, like what the piece could be. But what's so interesting is that I think a lot of people talk to them and go, well, it's a play. But, you know, you have some projection design and a director, but you know that, like, that kind of project could never have come together if it wasn't really them working as a collaborative. I mean, the ideas, the text, the design, like, everything was, you know, everyone was in each other's work. It was really, it wasn't so much here's a finished play and then here's the projection design or the direction, because there's no way that you could put together something like that without all moving forward at the same time. So it's also interesting, you know, for me as their touring producer, to try to talk to others about the work. And, you know, if you just send the play, it doesn't tell the whole story. You know, and that's not saying that Christine didn't, you know, ultimately pen a beautiful play. And there is a play, you know, that is written down. But essentially the play isn't just the written word.
Right. It's the nature of the experience. And then how do you control that? How do you have a sense of that? License and experience is interesting.
Yeah.
Okay. Does anybody have something that you want to say, share about this?
Yes.
I'll just say one thing that I think has been interesting to us is, in two cases now, titles, just because we've written for ourselves, and like I said, so we created Buddy Cop 2 not knowing it would be licensed, and it sounds like sort of like an ironic schlocky play, but it's a sort of like a sad, strange, melancholy play. And so we realized that, you know, somebody who's looking through the Sammy French catalog and sees the title Buddy Cop 2, who would want to do a play called Buddy Cop 2 is going to read the play and be like, that's not the play I want to do. But a company who might really sort of do a good version of that play might not, you know, be grabbed by that title, because there's sort of a collision between the title and the play that we use because we know who our audience is here. We know how to market ourselves. And then similarly, our next play, Blood Play,
which was the untitled,
which
World
was called
Fair
Untitled
Play.
No, it was
the untitled Blood. The World's Fair Play is now the Light Years.
Right.
That's right. Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So yeah,
it was. Blood Play was the untitled Blood Play.
Well, okay.
Which takes place in Chicago in the 50s, and it's about family and it's about bloodlines and it's also about violence. So we thought it was a good title. And when I told my mom, who lives in rural Minnesota, she's like, you can't call a play Blood Play. And other touring presenters said, we're going to have issues with that title. And it never would have crossed, it honestly never would have crossed my mind that the word blood in a title would be an issue for people. I'm saying, like, blood, not all these plays. My mom's like, yeah, nobody's going to go see a play called called Blood Play. You know, and so that's the other thing, that when we're creating for ourselves and for and presenting the work in a certain way, knowing that we're going to market it,
that's why,
and not
our
even
next
thinking
play,
that like somebody.
Literally, our next play is called Jacuzzi.
Which is, you know, yeah.
So controversial.
Exactly, exactly. But that is sort of a thing that we're talking with, you know, the people at Semi French about how to present our scripts, how to present our plays to, how to market them to people who, you know, who are going to do their own version of it. But what context to give them? Who to match it up with to say, oh, it's similar to, if you like the plays of this person, you might be interested in this. And I think that now with sort of technology, and we're sort of a very lo-fi company, but the idea of sort of technology and the, you know, website and ways that we can sort of present our work in ways that that people might consider doing them but otherwise right. might not be exposed to it. I think it's sort of an interesting time to be doing. When we first licensed our plays, we didn't know who to talk to about Young Jean Lee. Who do we talk to
right.
about like
right.
what the challenges are of a company with a written text and licensing?
And that's what's so interesting. Like if you have, you know, when you decide to license, it's a collaboration with your publisher, you know, in terms of what their market is, who has the market you really want, you know, what the level of profile you want. And these types of conversations, you know, how do you market it essentially for which market?
Right.
What do you change the title?
Yeah.
It's a really interesting conversation.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyone else want to have something that you do, Michael?
Yeah, I think I might be going backwards from what I missed with the
No, that's okay.
I think we talked about sort of a piece that started with site specific.
Okay, great. No, we haven't really talked about
it. Oh, okay.
No, so that's great.
I just mentioned.
Oh, well, we had a really interesting experience in the last 2 years.
Oh, yeah.
2 years ago, we got asked by the museum at the University of Pennsylvania to do a play in their space, which is an Egyptian hall. It's a recreation with actual ancient artifacts and the giant sphinx, and it's this absolutely stunning space. And so we wrote a play for that space, and it was, you know, absolutely written for that room. It was supposed to be taking place in that room on that evening, and
you had references to the things in the
and including this sphinx, which we made central to the plot. And John saw it. He was just sort of working in producing role, and he came to see it on opening night. And he came up to the intermission and said, "We have to take this to New York." I said, "I don't think we could take the whole room," but we did it.
And I said, "Ah,
we did it. We took it to New York the next summer. We played French last year, and I was really, I was so skeptical about how it was going to work, but we made it work. You know, just with projections and theatrical magic. But it changed the way I thought about the future of some of our pieces and some of the things that maybe we previously sat on or not put on the website, because I thought, it's for that time, it's for that place, it's for those people. But if somebody wants to do it, why shouldn't I let it be out there in the world? And
it's a really interesting point. You know, it ties into performance or any of those things of the live octopus. The fact that it's kind of a trust in your work that it can be translated in different ways and still maintain its potency and its power. I mean, that's an interesting thing, I think, to realize that it might not be done in exactly the same way, but imaginatively there's ways to get it across in a way that you feel satisfied with.
I always get the urge when I get a notice that something's being done. I look at the airline prices. Because I've yet to see, I think only once I've seen someone else really, you know, someone that I have no connection with take on one of my writings, and I would really love to. Some boarding school in Canada did everything that the Porch Room has published. It's like as one night, and I was like, I have to go to Saskatchewan. immediately.
That is such a litmus test. Because, you know, like Irene Fornes, always, who's a wonderful Cuban American writer, I worked with her for years, and she directed the first productions of all of her plays, you know, and she's pretty strict about that. because she wanted, you know, her visions were also directorial and she would do it. And then in a way she didn't care. And she said, okay, anybody can do it. But I don't want to see it, she said. You know, it's like, I don't want to see it. So it's like, it's out there. I had my, you know, you had that satisfaction, a little bit what you're talking about. You feel that you've done it, you've discovered it, you've done it, and then it can go out and anyone can do what they want. But it's a real litmus test, as they were saying. Do you want to see someone else do it, and what do they do with it, or is it something kind of, you can do it, but don't invite me.
I love, even just as a playwright or as a screenwriter, there's a bunch of groups I belong to, and I'll put something out for the group to review, and I'll read the comments that come back on it.
Yeah.
My favorite thing is when somebody comes back and says, I don't know if I love this or I hated it.
Yeah.
My second favorite thing is when somebody comes back and says, oh, I love this. I loved how you did that, and I loved where you did this, and I loved how you tied this back to this. And I'm like, no idea I was doing that, my friend, but I'm glad you, I'm glad you enjoyed it.
The interpretations. I think we're at the point where we can open it up for questions from the audience and also from, as they say, the interweb.
We've had actually a lot of great discussion going on. Y'all have a lot of tweets when you get off.
Oh, really?
But I think there's one that some people have been asking, which is, does seeing your show's license change your approach to new plays?
To creating a new play?
Just as to new plays. A couple people retweeted it, so I can take that however you like it.
Okay.
I would say for me it doesn't change at all the creation of the play. I'd say the one thing that changes is after the fact, just we like write in Samuel French formatting now, because the first play took me so long to like do, you know, but it's after the fact stage directions and after, there's more work after the fact with the script, but I don't think for us it changes anything.
And we said this, like, I don't regret any of our titles, but I didn't foresee the sort of challenges with Buddy Cop 2 or Blood Play, and I actually don't know that I would.
I don't think we'd change them.
No. But now that I know that, it probably will affect sort of what our plays get titled.
We were also cautioned against Cape Disappointment, which Samuel French just published when that first came out, because if it was the theater producing it was worried about the reviews of a play that had the word disappointment in the title. So I think every disappointment. Yeah. And that's a very interesting question, but for us, I don't think it hasn't changed at all.
I have found that if you write something to be marketable,
yes,
you will fail.
Mm. because if anybody had the formula, right, then...
Yes. You need to write the story you want to tell and trust that there is a market for it.
Yeah, I think it's a trap that you say, oh, this play is doing really, really well. Let me write another one like it. I mean, there's a lot of Hollywood stories like that, right, that we've seen. Yes. Yes?
Hi. I have a comment and a testimonial. The comment is, I've worked at Samuel French for 20 years. I've been on many panels. I've listened to many panels, and I've never heard a panel like this before. I think this is wonderful. Thank you for sharing your stories. Samuel French that thought this one up. I don't remember who it was. Maybe it was me, but it was mine. Second one's testimony. I'll make it very quick. Ronnie, you had referenced a story about a young child and an older man at the show. I took a colleague with me to that event, and I thought, oh, it's going to be interactive. We have to put on these T-shirts. The next thing I knew, we were involved. We took it very seriously. I was furious with that young child who chose to argue with me about what I thought should go into that time. I was furious with this child. It was one of the funnest and coolest play experiences I've had. If anyone has the opportunity to attend, I suggest you.
It's pretty good.
Is Dowgin Pony at all related to Dowgin Pony in Chicago or
no? No. So I should make sure I emphasize the Dowgin Pony DC, because there's a lot of Dowgin Ponies out there, which actually, if you don't mind me
changing
a little.
Please do.
I want to come back, but I had a quick question for the rest of you, which is something that I've been thinking a lot about, especially working with Dowgin Pony DC, is when you talk about licensing and other people doing the work and potentially saying, you know, by Dog and Pony DC or by such and such, do you get concerned that that work is going to be considered that it's you, not a another production of your work, but something that you are intimately involved with? It is your next show. It is the show.
Yeah, I think that is something that's like in the back of my mind, but
oh, depends.
I think
how you word it.
Well, and I think it's just something, you know, so you accept once it's out in the world, there are just certain things that are just going to be out of your hands. And you hope that people say, well, I want to look more into this porch room business, that I really enjoyed that play. I don't know. I think that most theater goers are savvy enough. So first of all, I think any theater that's going to put it on, it's going to be, this theater presents, drop. It was done by the Porch Room 10 years ago. So I think that's probably the case. But it is something that I think about, and I think it's a concern that has been probably out there in the world recently with the issues about rights and plays being seen for the first time in certain areas where they
Is that kind of wording and part of the license agreement? That it's supposed
usually.
To be done in a certain way, graphic, crediting in a certain way.
Yeah.
Well, and I know that there's crediting, and then there's also perception.
I might be a little bit like naive on this, but you know, I don't want anyone, you know, doing unlicensed productions of our work, and I don't want like the work being given away. But if I woke up in a world where I had like a big problem with unlicensed productions, and where my global brand was being like breached by, I feel like it falls under like the problems I wish I had. So it's like, those are good problems, you know? So until then, I'm a little bit like, you know, like again, You're Welcome, which is the show that's, you know, the show you sort of want to see done illegally, sort of. It's like, it's not a Sammy Price. Every time one of those is bought, you know, you just think like, oh God, I hope that there's some kid in his garage charging admission somewhere, you know? I don't know. So.
I mean, that goes back to the Creative Commons, you know, and when something is good, to just go into the Creative Commons, if they do it, you know, in scene class, that kids, you know, are doing it.
I like the idea of making money doing theater. Like, I love, I mean, solving how we make money doing this is like, that's an awesome challenge.
Yeah.
And so that's not at all the undercut. I think that's maybe the as noble an effort, but.
That's why I'm doing what I'm doing.
I wish that we have a third member of the Porch Room being here tonight, Pete Barry, and I think he would be extremely happy to find 12-year-olds doing our plays in the garage. I mean, that's
what he lives.
It was really him who pushed us to start putting our unpublished work up online, because Pete Barry
is a 12-year-old.
Yeah, well, that's his fault.
Will be until he's
and you know, he not only wants a future for his work to be out there, but he wants, if he's given inspiration to somebody and an opportunity to someone where they're not going to have to pay a particularly large licensing fee, there's no restriction. If you want to put it up in your garage, put it up in your garage. I think he feels really strongly that we're paying it back in some way.
Yeah.
I think it's a case-by-case thing, because on the other hand, you know, the idea of like somebody going into one of my plays and changing the words or changing the order of things, you know, that you know, sort of the protection that comes with that is very important. Again, but I could see a certain show that we would say, no, this is, you know, remix this, do what you want, and certain shows that we definitely wouldn't want that to be the case.
Yeah, and I think too, it's almost even there's a chance that, let's say, you know, some theater decides, you know, completely above board, does a production of Beer Town, but people who go see that show think, oh, this is actually the Dog and Pony DC company who's come out and done the show, when that isn't true. And that's not necessarily a good or a bad thing, you know, necessarily, but it's a question. Like, I don't know if that's something that people are concerned about or think about, but, and then we need to get back to you at some point, because I see what your question is.
Oh, no, like, actually, it's so weird. Like, I was going to just ask you guys about, like, as a like, child of hip-hop and, like, the internet, like, how you guys feel about people remixing your things in a way? Or, like, would that ever be, like, a big concern for you, since you guys are advisors yourselves? But, like, you guys sort of accidentally answered it just now, so it's cool.
I have a question here, then we're going to go to the internet.
I've been thinking about a play like Sister Banks' Death, which was more or less devised or collaborated, but for about 10 minutes. So he,
right, that's really, yeah.
Now, my question is, as a group, have you all made preparations for in case the relationship sours?
Like a prenup? Do we have prenups?
Because it was the band. I said, are you REM or are you the Beatles or who gets credit? You know? It was like REM, even though it was really a lot of songs were written by two people, the whole band, you know, would sort of participate. And with the Beatles, it's Lennon and McCartney, you know, so yeah. The licensing rights. So I kind of, and you have like Carol Churchill, you know, worked with joint stock, where you have a lot of, you know, writers who bring a writer in the room, and they're working with actors who are, I'm in that situation now, working with Josh Fox, who's creating a thing with an ensemble. All the actors are kind of improvising, but it's going to probably end up being under his name, and what's the agreement, and how does that work? I think it's a really interesting question. I don't know if it's quite any of these groups work that way, but... Well, Dowgin, you know, it's like, who gets us a devising company?
Yeah.
How royalties, how do you, you know, it held up Chorus Line for being a film for years and years, because it's like, who shares in the, not only the credit, the financing, also the decision. Does everybody vote who gets, well, you know, to the future of the show? That's a really interesting question.
I think it's a great question. I think, especially when we're talking to young companies, we talk about, I think there's two sides of it. One, just how much effort goes into managing the relationships in a company. Oliver made the joke of a prenup, but it is sort of like managing like a relationship. And when we talk to young companies...
You have to have a collaboration agreement at the beginning if you're going to go into this kind of work, because after the fact, you're already so emotionally connected to the piece, and it's very hard to unweave what has been woven or even remember where things have come from. I feel like there's a lot of expectations. I feel like it's a very touchy subject, and if you have a good thing going and created something beautiful with people, to have it after the fact, I feel like it's better to do the beginning to establish things. Also, as far as like, we've had like the plane crash conversations about like what happens in the end. I feel like we probably should have a bigger conversation though about what happens.
We had a long, the company was founded before I joined, but you know, we sort of revamped at one point when I was very entrenched. We had hours and hours of conversations about what we were and who we were and what the responsibilities were, and those questions of ownership and questions of collaboration agreement. And we hammered it out, and every once in a while we dusted off again and make sure we're still on the same
page. See if you need to renegotiate, see what needs to happen. I mean, you know, I was involved very much in the Rent case, you know, in terms of Jonathan Larson was collaborating with a dramaturg, Lynn Thompson. I remember Lynn, you know, in when it was developed, calling me up and saying, you know, how is it going? She said, oh, I'm writing some lyrics, you know, and whatever. And I said, do you and Jonathan have a collaboration agreement? And she said, oh, no, he's going to take care of me, which he would have. He had an aneurysm. He was gone. And it was like, there she was, you know, in a position where a grieving family, what you're trying to hone in and what's going on, and it ended up being, and it's like the legal thing about you have to claim co-authorship and all this other thing. But they didn't do it. They didn't get it down on paper. It was a mess. You had an internet thing?
Yes, so this is going back a little bit to licensing, but someone asked, if you change or update one of your works, how do you feel about a future licensee producing or presenting
an older
version of the work?
That's a really good question.
That makes sense. Or we all just think.
No.
I'm not, like if it's already licensed in one version and don't update it, or they just want to do the old version.
I think either or. So yeah, if you guys make changes and they want to do that older version.
I've never had it. I'm just trying to imagine what that would look like. I mean, I guess the closest thing that we have is that sometimes we'll get requests from people just like out of the blue saying, hey, I saw the play, can I have the script? And I guess we've never been in a situation where we've updated the license, so I can't quite answer that. But we have become aware of not wanting to have a bunch of different versions of a script floating around. If we've,
it never helps.
You know, if we've written it and then we have the version that we've adjusted and we've taken out some things that were just for us, and that that we are a little bit cautious of making sure that the version that we want to be out there is the version that's out there. So I would guess that if we did make big changes to a show, I think it would be a case-by-case thing, depending on what somebody really wanted to do with it. If they were both
if there was options to do it. But I would guess we want people to have the version that we want them
to have. Yeah, because I would guess if something went out in the world and then we changed it for a reason.
Right. I was going to say, I would be very interested to know why they wanted to do the older version and not the newer version.
It'd be a fun conversation.
What's weird for us is like the changes, like because we do continue to develop these after premiere, if they're further, you know, the blood play that we did at Williamstown had a number of changes from the one we did at the Bushwick Star.
Mm-hmm. The public was different than the Bushwick Star.
And I think it was a better, it's a better script in the end, but also it seems like, just when I think about it, it seems like the most, it would have to be like the most fastidious, like detail-oriented person. It was like, no, the like,
there's just like
words,
tiny bits of words to us are like huge.
You'd be like, you're a crazy person.
Yeah. This semi-French tweet. Does this sound like Yogi Berra? We try to make sure the version that is out there is the version we want out there.
I have to say, coming from my agenting experience, I would often fight moving quickly to publication until there have been a couple of productions, you know, and people love to get it out there, but I'd say, first of all, I really liked having the conversations as an agent with the field, you know, and when it goes to a publisher, you don't have those types of conversations as easily. But, you know, to get to rush and kind of say, I had this with a really terrific playwright who had one production, really wanted to get the play out there, and then a year later had another and went, oh my God, I'm totally rewriting this, but it was out there. It is easier to change now with a more print on demand. I mean, that technology has really changed things. There's not like 2,000, you know, necessarily, you know, 40,000 hard copies of your play all over the place. But it's, I think it's a question of like, hold off, have a couple of productions maybe before you rush into publishing. I mean, really make sure it's ready. But I'd just say, you know, that's a side note. Yeah.
And I think that's what kind of Beertown is.
And I think that's, Beertown's really wise to kind of what it's saying, is this is a Bible. It's more, let's really see, you know.
Yeah, there's a huge gap between ready and perfect.
Well,
it will never be perfect.
Right?
Perfect is the enemy. Perfect is the enemy of ready.
Yeah. Oh, I like that.
Tweet it.
I said as perfect as the enemy of ready. Yeah. Oliver Stone said as perfect as the enemy of good. So I'm not stealing from Oliver Stone because the last person I want coming after me is Oliver Stone doesn't mess around.
You have scripts that are for you versus it being for a larger audience. And I mean, I edited a lot of your plays, so I'm a little bit aware of like manuscript versus published version changes. But can you guys talk a little more, and maybe all of you, I know you mentioned some of the Bible, but kind of what metamorphosis your script goes through as you prep it for licensing? And how, like, what kind of fine-tuning do you do to kind of translate ideas or mood?
I feel like there's like little things that Paul and I might do in our character work that might not be essential to the character, but like maybe there's a hammy moment or there's like something, some tiny nuance that like would be too much information or just too, like sometimes when I read a play and they put in like a lot of beats or literally when it says beat, you know, sometimes I'm like, I want to discover that myself, why those thoughts are connected and that there's air in between. So I feel like, you know, we know that we would take a pause there, but that should come through in the storytelling.
I think we'll write in stage directions for things that we do even before we've done the play, just because we're like, oh, I want to remember that, like, we want to do this here, or this prop, we're going to move this here, or this is what this prop has to be, because we found this thing in an antique shop, and so we're putting in the script that, you know, pin from the World's Fair is there, and so it's often like stripping away stage directions, which is, I think, maybe a little counterintuitive, but it's stuff that you're like, oh, that was actually more a note for me to remember to do that than it was for, like, that's an important piece of action.
Yeah, but let then, someone enjoy that process and, like, discover that on their own if it's not essential to the storytelling.
But on the other hand, I think there's stuff that we would put in the script about mood that wouldn't be in the script that we did for ourselves, just because we know what that is, that we want to say, okay, this, you know, make sure that there's things, that this is bursting with the excitement of Christmas at the beginning of the play, or something like that, you know?
There's nothing more humbling than reading something you wrote 10 years ago when you were first started. Shut up.
<Yeah.
laughs> They get it.
Yeah.
You don't need 17 beats in a paragraph. 25-year-old idiot.
That's actually.
But then you go back and read Tennessee Williams today.
Right.
Really. She wafts in from the veranda, as effervescent as a Georgian summer. Maybe I can do this at times. Tennessee Williams got away with it.
Amy asking that actually just sparked a memory of something I'd kind of forgotten. But when we had our first piece published, dropped, we got hyper aware that it was going to be in print and kind of set in stone. And so we actually, I don't know if you remember, John, but we had a conference call right before we submitted the final edit, and we performed the play for ourselves.
No, I don't
yeah.
know.
We did, and
oh,
sure,
I do remember.
Yeah, making sure
that was
like,
the most surreal
oh,
thing ever.
Oh well, should he really say and there? Like we got hyper anal. In a way, we probably didn't really have to, but there was a feeling like, though this is it, it's going out there.
Yeah.
And there's no going back. So wanted to make sure it was
that's
exactly.
That's why I don't remember it because I zoned out because it was you and Pete talking about ants.
Oh right, yeah.
I think it's interesting. I think that. Dowgin Pony DC is actually in the opposite position in a way of you guys, in that, you know, for every action in Beertown, there's almost like a world of material behind it. So your experience of the show may be, you know, this person says one thing, the other person says another, but in a way, everything that each one of those characters has done was informed by, you know, 2 years of, you know, meetings talking about, okay, what's the history of this town? Workshops like with audience to kind of figure out, oh, what is this moment in the show? So, you know, in a way, it's almost like, okay, what is the, you want to give a tremendous wealth of background material so that the actors coming in can feel like they own the world. But at the same time, it's kind of hard to know what that information is, you know, because we might think that, oh, it's really important that you know this, this, and this. But someone doing the show may go, well, actually, that doesn't really help me feel like I own this. I need to have answers to these 5 questions. So it's almost like taking a, you know, so this is some of the thinking that's happening right now, is that, like, what is that information that needs to be shared to get that end result? Because it's not going to be so much of a stage direction and discover. You almost want to kind of give them, here's a world of material.
I feel like
that's actually
the exact situation that
yeah.
we find ourselves in, I think,
yeah.
because we create these mythologies of these worlds over a couple of years, and it is sort of what of that is important for people to know, because that is beneath the text what people are saying in stage direction. So I think that's really interesting that for us we sometimes boil it down to mood. And your production, the idea of having the Bible is so brilliant and so exciting for these groups. It's not something that would necessarily work for our plays, but there is sort of like. What of that do they need to know? Because they're not going to know that mythology. They're not going to know those things. But, you know, that leads to a mood or something. And do they need to know that?
I even remember I read your work before I saw a video of it. And was just kind of blown away by the difference in my head versus what I saw. Mm. You know?
Yeah.
It was interesting.
I mean, what you're saying, too, is like that everything can be useful in your world. And I just want to tell an anecdote because we had talked about Carol Churchill. There was some years when I was working in the public, I was really trying to talk Carol Churchill into doing kind of a hypertext, you know, piece with live and internet and hypertext work, because I thought her mind is so amazing that, you know, she would be great for it. She was really intrigued with it, and what really intrigued her, she said, oh my gosh, she said, I don't have to throw anything away. Which was a really kind of thing. Yeah, we have a couple repeat, but let's have new people. Yes.
Yes. I was actually thinking about sending you production directly. I'm sorry if I'm wrong. But irony, this is the age of irony. Have you addressed a situation where maybe somebody could take the text and do exactly the words that are written there, and it ends up meaning the opposite?
Yeah.
Yeah, that can happen.
In our play, You're Welcome, which is our cycle of bad plays, we have a note saying, do these as well as you can. Do these great. There's no wink. There's no irony in it.
Yeah.
And so we actually have a note saying that because people can very easily take that. Because we say they're bad plays, and it's called a cycle of bad plays, but the attempt is to do these really, really well, and there's some satisfaction in that. So we specifically have a note in one of our plays saying, don't do it with a wink. Do it really well, and let the badness
speak for itself.
Yes.
In answer to what you were just saying, doesn't that really depend on how good or bad the different actors are?
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, I mean, actor A may do it totally, totally one way, and actor B doing it the next night will make it very serious.
Yeah.
I don't know if you're leaving that open for that.
I mean, I guess you have, for sure. I mean, we can tell them exactly sort of what our values were behind it and then how they execute it.
They'll interpret that,
yeah. And that's sort of the fun of the game, yeah.
I mean, it's a question for, you know, anyone who puts something out there as text. You know, like you look at, Eugene O'Neill, who wrote extensive stage directions, you know, and I've been where they're all crossed out, you know, the director crosses them all out. And then it's really funny because I've been in productions where the director will go, oh, I think I'm going to do this. And I'm looking at the stage directions because I have the version that they're in. Doing exactly what O'Neill said.
That's
really funny.
Our professor always used to say that the filmmaker can reshoot, the writer can edit, the painter can repaint, the stage artist can stand in the back of the room and smack his or her head against the wall.
I love that. Is that your quote?
No.
Whose quote is that?
Did Charlie steal it from anyone?
Oh, man.
Probably.
That's right.
It's Charlie original.
Professor Charles Richter.
Yeah. Question regarding beer time. Suppose an audience member comes in with something that really steals the whole show and you want to use it. Do you get your audience to sign a release?
Good question.
So it's interesting because the way that the show is framed is that space is being made for the audience to debate about the objects. So in a way, that space is always going to be there. So if someone comes forward and makes an impassioned speech about something, that is kind of the special treat of being in the audience that night because you get to hear that. So because it's interesting trying to kind of put words to this, but so Doug and Pony, what they like to say about Beer Town is it's kind of like their Valentine to democracy. So in a way, it's just as much about making space for the audience to have this really exciting experience and this agency as much as the product of like what comes out of it. Because the experience of being in the room is so exciting. So I doubt, although, you know, Rachel's not here to say what you think, so this is what, you know, current producer thinks, but I think that would be a rare, that might not so much happen with Beer Town.
But it's an interesting thing because in playwright contracts, you know, you have a contract that says the writer owns the work. Doesn't matter who in the room, you know, the director, the actors give in, you have a right to own that work. So it's an interesting thing. Do you have that thing? Let's go to do you have something on the internet?
I do. Someone was wondering, how does it feel to be known and published as a collective rather than as an individual?
That was the curiosity I always sort of, because several of you do publish individually.
I feel so excited to when we were able to like make a page on our website of like all our books and have these things that we made together and seal all of our names on it. It's really exciting. I haven't published anything by myself, but
I haven't published anything by myself either, and I really love my collaborators. And
I thought you had a couple things. No,
not by myself.
Okay.
But I'm really proud of it all, and I'm really happy. So far, so great, so good.
We've really tried to, not just in publishing, but in general, like our feeling is like what's good for us individually is good for the company, and what's good for the company is good for us individually. So, like in publishing, you know, making sure that both the company, the collaboration, and us individually are represented in a way that makes us feel proud is a are long conversations that we have to make sure they're right. And I feel completely at peace with both my part in the collaboration, and I feel warm and fuzzy about the brand of the Debate Society, the sound of it, the name, the team.
It's also that we do work individually and other things, but we create something together that none of us would create individually, so it's so exciting to share that. And it's so great to be able to spend a life making making something with these two partners that you're like, this is what I want to spend my life doing. And that's worth getting, you know, residual checks that are one third of a residual check because, you know, because we're splitting everything three ways. But that's just, you know, that's, I love it.
I think if you worry too much about that, you're not going to last too long in a collective anyway.
Yeah.
Can I actually ask the group a question?
No.
Okay.
You can tweet it.
Yeah, I'll tweet it. But do you ever have projects where any one of you might have a project and you think ultimately that's not a group project?
Yeah. That's definitely come up. I mean, we brought stuff to the table that hasn't like seemed appropriate, and that's fine. I mean, like we have so many projects going. There's like not. There aren't like slots open and time waiting to be used. So, that's happened for us.
Certainly happened to us.
Yes.
Two things. One, in response to your question, because I did get a chance to see Beer Town, and it seemed like, and this is just from observing that a number of the cast members, having seen so many conversations and discussions around certain items, would sort of incite discussion and arguments sort of based on, you know, knowing this, you know, pin, and it seemed like, oh, they'd seen somebody bring up this particularly good argument, and so they'd sort of bring that up to incite other people to have that conversation.
Yeah.
So it wasn't necessarily like they were stealing the particulars of it, but it's more of like, how do we, I think that's a large part of what they're doing is figuring out how to encourage discussion and encourage people to have strong opinions about things that they would sort of, based on having done it 40, 50 times, they would say, oh, this point seems to really cause a big stir.
Yeah.
And so through that, they would sort of help shape what was going on.
Yeah, so I might almost call it that it's like a tool that they're adding to their arsenal.
Yeah.
You know, that
yeah.
it's like, oh, that was a really rich moment. What were the circumstances that really let that happen? And, like, how can we kind of, you know, encourage that again?
And then just sort of the other question, I'm curious, apart from the publishing thing, has that been a struggle in terms of building your career and how you deal with sort of the brand of a company versus developing your sort of own individual career? Has that been a struggle? Or has that just sort of happened by itself? I'm not something you have to worry about.
Paul tried to have a solo album momentarily. We let him. We told him it was a bad idea. Yeah. I mean, it's happened more and more. I mean, it used to be that we just sort of like, we'd do a play every year and a half and wouldn't be working on anything else, and now we always have like two or three plays in development and then are doing other things. And the three of us also do the business of the company. So, Oliver just directed the open house at the Signature and Hannah was in it. So for those 2 months, sort of the work of the company was like falling on me. And then,
well, Paul came with like our board and these like other donors we were cultivating and like brought him. We like bought a whole block of tickets and used it as like a cultivation event.
Mm-hmm.
And we also run a company, so things like cultivation events sort of make sense. But that's a part of the like how what's good for the company is good for the individual. It's also great because we make stuff that we want to make, that we want to be a part of.
Mm-hmm.
And so, the work that we get outside of the company, most of the time comes from people who have seen our work and respond to our work.
Mm-hmm.
And so a playwright or a director or another actor, in a lot of ways it's just logistics. It's logistics of like, of balancing the different projects, but for me, I think it's particularly satisfying just because it's coming from it's this community, it's this theater community, people that you respond to their work, and it's not about schmoozing and trying to, you know, it's about people who respond to your work and work with them on other things, and just finding the time to balance it. And we know that there's room for that, and that the other one picks up the slack when somebody else is doing something else, and that people will see a show that Hannah's in and want to see her again, and they'll come to see the next debate site show.
It's also like making, you know, like having our company and then also writing other things or acting in other people's project. It's like, it's all part of like my body of work,
mm-hmm.
you know? So I feel like it's not something that I'm worrying about when I'm not doing my own project. I feel like as long as you're like trying to do good work, it will define itself, and it's sort of, it's all adding to your creative resume.
Right. I think we have, do you have one?
Oh, I was going to say quickly that it's interesting you should ask that, because working with four different artists and ensembles in D.C. as part of Theatre from the District, you know, I find that some of the most like rich kind kind of worlds that are being built in terms of relationships with other artists, with just interesting people, are when ensembles are made of three, of, you know, many individuals that each have their own rich networks, and it just kind of makes the work land in the world a lot more richly when that happens. And it's really just great to see how, see the ripple effect from, you know, other people's involvement in other projects. So that's been an interesting, looking at it from a producer perspective.
I think it's kind of a great way to end, and I think it's kind of the strength of this collaborative work, and I think it's a great model for the country, quite frankly.
You guys were amazing. Thank you so much. And I hope you guys can join us. We have two more that are coming up. Amy Rose Marsh is actually moderating tomorrow's after Thank you all for coming. We don't want the conversation to end, so keep it going on Twitter. And one last time, let's hear it for them.